Hello everyone. If you're returning, welcome back. If you're new, thank you for stopping by, and hopefully you find some videos here that you enjoy. I will be linking both the most recent Men Writing Women video and playlist in that top corner during this video. One will be at the beginning here and one will be at the end. I know it's been a little bit since my last video, but that is largely because I finally got myself a new job after getting laid off at the start of the pandemic. Perfect timing for it too, and I'm so happy with the one that I got. It's awesome so far. I'm gonna have to start batch filming the voiceover parts at least, so that way I can edit them when I get home from work and not have to worry about any other noises around here. So hopefully you like this video. If you do, please consider giving it a thumbs up, commenting down below, or even subscribing to my channel and turning on the bell to be notified of future videos. I will continue to upload as much as I can. I'm just not sure on how often that's going to be now. Today we are going back into the world of Men Writing Women. I had planned to give it at least a couple more videos before I went back there, but there was a lot of good stuff in there when I was looking, so that's where we're going today. Hope you enjoy. Well, that was some refreshing introspection. Doing it right. Confident in my ability to properly tennis, I take the court. I smile at my opponent. Serena does not return the gesture. She serves. The ball passes cleanly through my skull, ending me instantly. And this is in response to the post that we've seen a few times around. 1 in 8 men, or 12%, say they could win a point in a game of tennis against 23-time Grand Slam winner Serena Williams. Hey, at least this guy's honest. He knows he wouldn't have a chance. Uno reverse card once again, doing it right. I'm going to write about man parts the way male writers write about Bob's. His nuts, once so full and heaving in the summers of his youth, now clung to his pelvis as a reminder of the cold and his powerlessness. That one's pretty amusing. Now, if only more people would write men like that, so maybe men would learn to actually write women properly? Just a thought. But they're on to us. How to fascinate a woman. From either a book or a chapter titled Spells, Charms, and Incantations. Take a shoe that the woman you love has worn, fill it with rue, and hang it over your bed to make her love you. If it's a woman who really loves her shoes, she'll get probably pretty angry at you if you do this. If it's a woman who only has a single pair of shoes, oh, she's never gonna talk to you again if you take her only one of her only shoes. And now to the next part. To win a maiden's love, get a hair and a pin off her unperceived. Twist the hair around the pin, and then throw them backwards into the river. What, you're gonna go up to someone and basically grab a bobby pin with the piece of hair tied to it without her noticing? What, are you gonna do something really bad to her first so that she's not actually awake for you to do this? Cause she'll feel it when you take that out of there. And then throw it backwards into a river. That doesn't make any sense. And here's the fun one. You may fascinate a woman by giving her a piece of cheese. Yeah, maybe if it's a 5-year-old child. The only person I know who is always happy to have cheese and always wants cheese is my young niece. I don't know of a single adult woman who would be fascinated if you gave her a piece of cheese. Like, come on, who wrote this? How will I introduce this young girl character? What's important and unique about her? Oh, I know. I'll tell everyone she has bobs and pubes. This is from The Woman on Hester Street, 1969, Varya. So this is a prologue. Varya is 13. New to her are 3 more inches of height and the dark patch of fur between her legs. Her bobs are palm-sized, her nips pink dimes. Her hair is waist-length and medium brown. Not the black of her brother Daniel's or Simon's lemon curls, not Clara's glint of bronze. No, her hair is medium brown. A very boring color compared to bronze or lemon. But she's 13. Why are you describing that she has pubes and palm-sized bobs with dime-sized nickels? Nickels, really? And dime-sized nips. Come on now. It's a 13-year-old. Don't describe them this way. Definitely the weirdest bob metaphor I've ever read. Perfume, the story of a murderer. She was indeed a girl of exquisite beauty. She was one of those languid women made of dark honey, smooth and sweet and terribly sticky. Sticky? Why are you describing someone as sticky? Who'd take control of her room with a syrupy gesture. Oh, so now she's sticky and takes control of rooms with syrupy gestures. Go eat some pancakes and calm down, dude. Come on now. A toss of hair and a single slow whiplash of the eyes, and all the while remain as still as the center of a hurricane, apparently unaware of the force of gravity by which they irresistibly attract to themselves the yearnings and the souls of both men and women. So she's remaining as still as the center of the hurricane while controlling the room with a whiplash of her eyes and syrupy gestures from her sticky self. And she was young, so very young, that the flow of her allure had not yet grown vicious. Her full limbs were still smooth and solid, her bobs plump and pert as hard-boiled eggs. Those must be some teeny tiny oddly shaped ones if they're gonna be described as hard-boiled eggs. Like, come on now. Unless maybe you're cutting the eggs in half and it's barely a nip, just it's like a giant nip on there. Like, what the hell? And the planes of her face, brushed by her heavy black hair, still had the most delicate contours and secret places. Her hair, however, was gone. The murderer had cut it off and taken it with him, along with her clothes. Well, if it wasn't for a title saying that this was a story of a murder, I never would have expected that at the end of it. You hear the rest of the description and you don't think that this is someone whose life has been ended, the hair has been cut off, and the clothes are missing. What? Like, please don't write like this. This is just weird. Oh, and it gets better. People suspected the gypsies. Gypsies were capable of anything. Gypsies were known to weave carpets out of old clothes, and to stuff their pillows with human hair, and to make dolls out of skin and teeth of the hanged. Only the gypsies would be involved in such a perverse crime. There were, however, no gypsies around at the time. Not a one near or far. So clearly it's not gypsies. And I think a serial ender might be more inclined to do something like this than a gypsy. Unless you want to say in this book that all gypsies are basically serial enders? I don't know. I definitely wouldn't read this book personally. That's just too weird. First one I personally found in the wild. Marilyn is wearing her work dress, a LeMay creation with a plunging neckline which clings to her body. She raises her arms, which tantalizingly accentuate the flawless flow of her curves, the perfect arch of her back, her smooth, tensed belly, her outrageously rounded buttocks, and her curved bobs high up because she is perched at the top of a ladder, rehanging the last of the little paintings from the frieze of apples. Okay, you don't need to describe someone in that way when they're hanging paintings. Come on now, people. I'm gonna have to see if I can find the screenshot I took of an ebook which had the first one I ever found. It was really weird. Apparently, whoever wrote that one is under the impression that when you're doing stuff for the first time, you don't need to wear condoms because it's not possible to get pregnant. I'm sure there's a lot of people out there who would actually disagree with that. Oh, some more Stephen King. Always the favorite amongst that subreddit. Exactly what anyone would think when rescuing a toddler from the middle of the road, right? This is from Bag of Bones. You take me beach? The little girl asked. She was bright-eyed, smiling. I figured that she'd probably be pregnant by the time she was 12, especially given the cool way she was wearing her baseball cap. Got your suitie? The way she was wearing her baseball cap suggests that she would be pregnant by the age of 12? What? Yeah, I got nothing to that one. And now we go into scientific writing that is possibly worse than the fictional. This is from a public Facebook group. Apologies if not allowed. This is the answer we received from a journal with IF 9.26 in the category Biochemistry, Genetics, and Molecular Biology from Springer. The paper is about stem cell therapy using stromal cells from menstrual blood, which are now deeply studied and have shown a great potential and safety by many authors. Welcome to the middle age. All right, and here is the comment or post in question. In general, the topic idea is not that novel and could not be accepted as it is, since almost all articles in the literature reported the severe, undesirable, and toxic effects of menstrual blood and all of its constituents, including menses, on the human body. Even in all religions, it is well known that menstrual blood and its menses are extremely, very toxic and of very low quality. This blood contains the destructive metabolic constituents with very potent cytotoxic activities, thus the toxicological criminology. Some women in some cultures use a few drops of its potent toxic extract to secretly kill their husbands. I highly doubt that menstrual blood is going to kill people in very small quantities like that. I doubt that women are saving up their menstrual blood so that they can end their husbands. In addition, why I have to spend that much money to enhance the immunomodulatory capacity of insecure toxic menses when I can invest much less money in developing very safe synthetic and natural agents and of even more potency to satisfy the same purpose and more. This idea or matter also is not practically interesting or favorable since it has significant privacy in females. Do not forget that menstrual blood contain their own ova, genomics, husband sperm, and genetic material, etc., along with the great possibility of increasing microbial blood infection transmission. Well, it would appear that the author of that comment is of a very different opinion than everyone else. Plus, as it mentions, they're looking to do stem cell therapy using the stromal cells for menstrual blood, which has been shown to have great potential and be very safe, not like everything else that this other person said. All right, on to the next one. I don't think that's how it works. As a sock scientist, in her first year, she had gone through the men like an enema. Now they considered her to be a wholesome. She agreed she was, except she never took money. Perhaps later she would experiment with money, but at the moment, she was a hothouse plant and loved it. She's a hothouse plant? Really? Outside of the loft where Mrs. Spark was holding her supposed literary meeting, Anna Spark listened at the keyhole. Her curved bobs were tense with concentration. Yes, the breast tense in concentration when you're listening to something. That's how it works. Right. She could not hear exactly what was being said, but she sensed that her mother was experimenting in the other dimension.
In the other dimension now? Well, maybe that's why they said it that way. Maybe it's an alien.
Some alien bobs might tense in concentration, but certainly not human ones. The children stood arms akimbo. They were not going to be pushed around by the desire which rippled along her nips. She realized she would have to make them a promise. She called Billy over and whispered in his ear,
Billy, bring the gang to the giant oak at about 6:30 tonight, and we will continue our nature ramble. Now, don't argue. We have a lot to do before tomorrow night.
So is this describing an adult woman who is trying to use desire to get children to do what she wants? If that's what it is, that's very disturbing. She moved towards the village, allowing her hips to continue the conversation. Anna turned her head to see if her rhythmical magnet was functioning properly. It was. She stopped, pursing her nips towards him and then swung on. How do you purse your nips? You can purse your lips? But not your nips. Like, come on. This has to be describing an alien of some kind. Or maybe that's what the author themselves are, and they don't understand humans at all. The left bob was fractionally larger than its sister. It was Anna's favorite. She flexed it towards the wall. Okay, so now she is flexing a single bob towards the wall because it's bigger and she likes it better. There's no way this is a human. No way. Not even possible. We got two more to go now. Trad Chad reformed six women with just a whiteboard and a marker.
I was in a prominent restaurant in Mumbai waiting for my friend. It was posh and expensive place. In the adjacent tables, there were six women dressed in micro minis. There was a scribbling board at the restaurant. I took the marker and wrote the following sentences. In our traditional Indian culture, everyone used to wake up early, take bath early, dress properly, do puja. I have no clue what that is. Have prasadam
Again, I don't know what that is.
Follow proper etiquette. Work very clean and neat in appearance and used to attract people by their fragrance of good qualities.
Good qualities have a fragrance now?
I didn't know that. But now, these qualities are fast eroding. People are trying to attract others by exposing their bodies and not qualities. Kali Yuga. Those micro minis read this one by one and then came to me for an argument. End of the argument, they thanked me and felt bad. Few women cried and said, no one told us this kind of revealing dress is bad. We thought we are the fad. Now we know it's not fad, but bad.
Anyone else here want to vote that this never happened? Or if they wrote that there, that's the response they wanted but never got? Because I don't think this happened. This is probably all in this guy's imagination. Yes, you're going to write something like that and women are going to come up to you and try and argue, but what you wrote will make them feel bad and to start crying? No. Sorry, buddy. Didn't happen.
The female nether regions connect with the mouth. This is a quote. To be honest, female nether region has a bad example since it technically goes from there all the way out of the mouth.
Comment here. You thinking of anuses, bro.
What kind of nether region goes there to the mouth?
Mine.
Really?
Hentai isn't real, bro. I'm talking about if debone the girl and her organs dummy. Basically the human body, like anatomy, the question marks. What are you even saying right now? Yeah, sorry dude. Real human anatomy is not what you find in hentai. Those two don't connect like that.
The first commenter had it right. There's a lot more little systems to go through to connect that.
And really, you're talking about if you debone a girl and the organs, like, what, now you're gonna go even worse into stuff like this? Come on.
Yeah, I think that's enough men writing women for today.
Well, hopefully you like today's men writing women. There are certainly some interesting ones in there.
A little more interesting than normal, shall I say?
A lot of these men really need to go and learn how the female body works, because a lot of this stuff is not what you're going to ever see.
But in the meantime, comment down below if you've come up with or seen anything really weird like this. Any pictures of quotes from books that you find from men writing women, if you don't want to go post them on Reddit, or if you want to make sure you see them show up in a future video, even if it's something that you find on social media somewhere, be sure to send it to the email that's linked in the description down below. You don't have to post it somewhere. I'll still read it for this, provided it's one that actually is able to be read publicly like this. But anyways, I will see you all in the next video.
Bye!